Hello everyone. So in this video, we shall learn about the refinement of a partition. So we know already a partition means a partition of a closed interval a comma b is nothing but a finite set of points taken from a to b. So now we shall see what is refinement of a partition. So let p be a partition of a closed interval a comma b. A partition P star of A comma B is said to be a refinement of P if P star contains P. So that means for a given partition P of closed interval A comma B, refinement of P is nothing but once again a partition. It is denoted by P star. So refinement of a partition P is nothing but one more partition P star which contains P. So such a partition is called refinement of the partition P. So next, so given two partitions, let P1 and P2 be any two partitions of closed interval A comma B, then consider their union. So P star is union of P1 and P2. So as P1 and P2 are partitions, so both are finite set of finitely many points from A to B. So union of two finite sets is again a finite set which contains finitely many points from A to B. So hence P star will also be a partition of A comma B. And this partition is called common refinement of P1 and P2. So this is because, so P star is a partition of A comma B such that P star is P1 union P2. So the union contains both the sets. So P star contains P1, P star contains P2. As P star contains P1, we can say P star is a refinement of P1. And also as P star contains P2, P star will be a refinement of P2. So I can say P star is a common refinement of both P1 and P2. So it is called common refinement of P1 and P2. So it is a refinement for both P1 and P2. And it is got by taking the union of given two partitions. So given any two partitions, so their union will be nothing but a common refinement for both P1 and P2. So this is about refinement of a partition and common refinement of a given two partitions. So now we shall come to a result regarding a refinement of a partition P. Let F be a bounded real valued function defined on a closed interval a comma b and alpha be any monotonically increasing function on closed interval a comma b. If p star is any refinement of a partition p of closed interval a comma b, then l p f alpha is less than or equal to l p star f alpha and u p f alpha is greater than or equal to u p star f alpha. So this is a result regarding a refinement P star of a partition P. So we shall prove it. So start with the refinement P star of a partition P taken as set x0, x1, xn minus 1, xn of a comma b. So as we have seen, so a partition P is nothing but a set of finitely many points from A to B. So now I have taken P to be partition, so containing the points x0, x1, x2, x3, so on, xn minus 1, xn, where x0 is nothing but A, xn is nothing but B. Now, as P star is a refinement of P, so by the definition, P star contains P. So P star contains P means, so P star contains some finitely many points from A to B in which the elements of P also there. So P star is a refinement of P means what? P star is basically a partition of closed interval A comma B. So such that it contains finitely many points from A to B such that it also contains the points of P. So P star, P star basically contains all the points of P, and in addition to that, it may contain some other points from A to B. So along with the points of P, P star may contain some other points from A to B. But at last, P star has to be finite. So it cannot contain infinitely many points other than P. So as P star is a partition, strictly it has to contain finitely many points. So first of all, as P star contains P, it has to contain all the points of P. In addition to that, P star could be bigger than P. So it means P star can contain some more points of closed interval A comma B other than the points of P. Now for our convenience, first we shall assume that suppose P star contains just one point more than P, right? So P star contains only one point more than P. Say that point is X star. X star. So what that means? So if I consider the partition P star, so what is it? It is a set of finitely many points from A to B. So first point is X naught, last point is Xn. Last point is Xn. Right? So P star obviously contain all the points of P. So it contains X1, it contains X2, it contains X3, so on. It contains Xn minus 1, Xn. So in addition to that, it contains only one point more than P. So I have taken that point as X star. So in addition to X0, X1, X2, so on, Xn minus 1, Xn. So there is one extra point X star in P star. So just to locate that point, so it could be in between any two Xi's, right? So apart from these Xi's, so X star is an extra point. So it could be in between any two Xi's, right? So just to take the location, say it is in between Xj minus 1, Xj, right? Suppose it lies in between Xj minus 1, Xj. Okay. So I have taken that. So let X star be such that it lies in between Xj minus 1 and Xj for some j. So it could be anywhere. So it could be in between X star and X1. It could be in between X1 and X2. It could be in between X2 and X3 like this. It could be in between Xn minus 1 and Xn also. So in general, I have taken it is in between Xj minus 1 and Xj. Okay. So now we shall prove L of P star F alpha is greater than or equal to LP F alpha. So first you have to be clear with the partition P and the partition P star. So what is partition P? So it is the points X0, X1, X2, so on, Xn minus 1, Xn, which is nothing but B. So this is P. So in between, so there will be Xj minus 1, Xj also. Now what is P star? So it is a finite set of points from, once again, A to B only. So first of all, it has to contain all the points of P. So it contains all X0, X1, X2, X3, Xj minus 1, Xj like this. So it contains X1, it contains X2, so on, Xj minus 1, Xj, so on, Xn minus 1, Xn. So in addition to this, it contains only one point more than those points which I have taken as X star. And say it is in between Xj minus 1 and Xj, right? Okay, so now we have to define these two terms, right? So what is LPF alpha? How we have defined LPF alpha? So we define it to be Mi into delta alpha I running from 1 to n, where what is Mi? Mi is the infimum of all f of x as x varies over any ith interval xi minus 1 xi. So what that means? So for each interval, so as you know, each partition divides the closed interval a comma b into sub intervals, right? Sub intervals like this. So xj minus 1 xj, xn minus 1 like xn. Here also x0 to x1, x1 to x2 like this. Here So in case of P, it was the closed interval xj minus 1 xj, but here, so that closed interval is again splitted into 2, xj minus 1 x star, xj, so on like this. Right? So for each subinterval, we'll calculate the infimum. So then we'll sum up all the values for each subintervals. That is m1 into delta alpha 1 plus m2 into delta alpha 2 plus so on. With respect to this, it is mj into delta alpha j plus so on. Finally, mn into delta alpha n. So this is nothing but LPF alpha. So it is summation mi delta alpha I ring from 1 to n. So LPF alpha is summation mi delta alpha I running from 1 to n. So just I'll split it. So just to highlight the jth interval, highlight this interval xj minus 1 xj. So the infimum of this interval is mj, so into delta alpha j. So just to highlight the jth term, so I'll take this out of the summation. So I run from j to I 1 to j minus 1, jth term, then summation running from j plus 1 to n. So just I have highlighted the jth term. So this is LPF alpha. Now we shall write the lower Riemann Stiele sum with respect to the partition P star, right? So we know that LPF alpha means what? It is the lower Riemann Stiele sum with respect to the partition P. Now we shall write the lower Riemann Stiele sum, that is L P star F alpha with respect to partition P star. So what is it? It is once again, so for each closed interval, calculate the minimum into delta alpha I, into delta alpha I. So if you compare the partition P and P star, so except the jth interval, rest all intervals are same, right? So x0 to x1 is there, here also x0 to x1, x1 to x2, x1 to x2, x2 to x3, x2 to x3, like this. But in partition P, in case of partition P, so the jth interval is xj minus 1 xj. But in place of jth interval, in case of P star, we have two intervals, xj minus 1 to x star to xj minus 1. So the single jth interval is splitted into two in case of P star. So in writing the lower Riemann Stiele sum with respect to P star, so we have to consider these two subintervals of the xj minus 1 xj interval. So up to here, so the same intervals as there, so we can write the same terms as in the case of LPF alpha. And after jth interval also, there are same terms. So we can write the same terms as in the case of LPF alpha. So only the jth term differs. So this only the difference between LPF alpha and LP star F alpha is the jth term. So in place of jth term, so we have two terms. Say, so with respect to these two intervals, we have to calculate the infimum. So I'll say W1 is the infimum of this interval. W2 is the infimum of all function values for points in this interval. So let W1 be infimum of all f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 to x star. W2 is the infimum of f of x from x star to xj. So just I'll enlarge the jth interval xj minus 1 to xj. So in between there is x star. So this is one interval, this is one interval now. So W1 is the supremum for all points in this case, and W2 is the supremum for all function values for points in this interval. So now if I write LP star F alpha, so up to the jth term, so first j minus 1 intervals are same, x0 to x1, x1 to x2, like this. So these all sub intervals are one and the same. So their infimums will be same. We can borrow the same infimums here also. So up to j minus 1 intervals, so the terms are same. And also after the jth term, after the jth term, so the rest all terms up to nth term are also same. only the jth interval is splitted into two. So with respect to that, so there are two terms. So W1 into alpha of x star minus alpha of xj minus 1 plus W2 into alpha of xj minus alpha of x star. So that is what I have written. So just I have applied delta alpha I for these two intervals. So what is in general delta alpha I? It is xi minus xj minus 1. That is upper limit, that is alpha of xi minus alpha of xj minus 1, xi minus 1. So that is alpha of the upper limit minus alpha of lower limit. Here also, so delta alpha I with respect to the first interval is alpha of upper limit, that is x star minus alpha of xj minus 1. With respect to this, alpha of xj minus alpha of x star. So that is what we have written. So this is equation 2. So this is the crucial step in this theorem. So writing LP F alpha and LP star F alpha is very important. So just use the definition of lower Riemann-Stiele sum and write LP F alpha and LP star F alpha. So the only difference is, so in case of P, we have only one jth interval, xj minus 1 to xj. So that interval is splitted into two in case of P star. So there will be two terms in place of the one term with respect to J. Now, from 1 and 2, consider the difference L P star F alpha minus L P F alpha. So up to J minus 1, so both the equations contain same terms, so they get cancelled. And after the jth term, up to nth term also, both the equations contain same terms. So they get cancelled when you take the difference. So the remaining is, this is the jth term of P star and this is the jth term of P. That is jth term of L P star F alpha and this is the jth term of L P F alpha. So this is what will be remained after taking the difference, L P star F alpha minus L P F alpha. So now, so MJ into delta alpha J means what? So this is the interval xj minus 1 xj. So delta alpha j minus alpha of upper limit minus alpha of lower limit. So alpha of xj minus alpha of xj minus 1. Now compare. So here x star xj minus 1 is there. Here xj x star. So here there is no x star. So we shall introduce x star. So in the last term, mj into is there. So in that, inside the bracket, so add and subtract alpha of x star. So mj into alpha of xj minus alpha of x star plus alpha of x star minus alpha of xj minus 1. So combine these term, that is alpha of xj minus alpha of x star and alpha of x star minus alpha of xj minus 1. Now we can find the common. So this term is common for mj and w2. And this term is common for MJ and W1. So take the common. So W1 minus MJ will into alpha of X star minus alpha of XJ minus 1. W2 minus MJ into alpha of X star minus alpha of XJ minus alpha of X star. Now, according to our assumption, so X star lies in between XJ minus 1 and XJ. So as alpha is a monotonically increasing function, alpha of xj minus 1 will be less than or equal to alpha of x star less than or equal to alpha of xj. As the domain points increase, the corresponding function value should also increase. So by this inequality, so alpha of x star minus alpha of xj minus 1 has to be non-negative. Alpha of xj minus alpha of x star has to be non-negative. So as this number is greater than or equal to this one, so difference has to be non-negative. Obviously. And now, so this is the point which you have to observe. So W1 is greater than or equal to MJ, W2 is greater than or equal to MJ. So what is MJ? MJ is the infimum of all f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 xj. So infimum means what? It is the greatest lower bound. So whereas what is W1? W1 is infimum of f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 to x star, and W2 is infimum of all f of x as x varies from x star to xj, where x star is in between xj minus 1 to xj. So from xj minus 1 to up to xj, so for all these points, infimum of f of x is mj. So it is a greatest lower bound. That is, it is a lower bound for all f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 to xj. In particular, so it will be a lower bound for all points varying from xj minus 1 to x star. So if I vary x from xj minus 1 to x star, so for all these f of x values also, mj will be a lower bound. But whereas w1 is what? It is greatest lower bound. So w1 is a greatest lower bound for these values, whereas mj is a lower bound for these values. So any lower bound will be less than or equal to the greatest lower bound. Similarly, so w2 is the greatest lower bound for all f of x values as x varies from x star to xj. But as I vary x from x stars to xj, f of x values are also bounded below by mj. So mj is a lower bound for all these values as x varies from x star to xj, whereas w2 is a greatest lower bound. So greatest lower bound has to be greater than or equal to any lower bound. So mj forms a lower bound for these values, whereas w1 and w2 are greatest lower bounds respectively. So greatest lower bound has to be less than or equal to any lower bound. So w1 is greater than or equal to mj, w2 is greater than or equal to mj. So w1 minus mj will be non-negative, w2 minus mj will be non-negative. So this is non-negative, this is non-negative. So this term is also non-negative, this term is also negative. So overall, the right-hand side will be non-negative. So the left-hand side, which is equal to that, will also be non-negative. So which gives you L of P star F alpha is greater than or equal to L P F alpha. So we obtain the required result. So this is in case P star contains only one point more than P. So what is P? P star, it is contains all the points of P and it contains only one point more than P. So P star is P union one point. So whenever P star contains one point more than that of P, we proved the result. Suppose it contains K points. Suppose it contains finitely many points more than P. So just apply what we have applied for single point. So assuming P star contains only one point more than P, so we proved the result. So what we applied for that single point, so x star was in between xj minus 1, xj. So what we have done for x star, so repeat the same for those k points. If at all P star contains k points more than P, then the above reasoning is repeated k times for k points. For each point, apply the same procedure. So finally, you will obtain L P star F alpha will be greater than or equal to L P F alpha once again. So just repeat the above process for each of the points which are in extra, which are extra with respect to P, right? So this completes one part of the theorem with respect to the lower Riemann-Stiele sum. So for any refinement P star of P, so its lower Riemann-Stiele sum will be always greater than or equal to LPF alpha. That is lower Riemann-Stiele sum with respect to P, right? So now we shall repeat the same with respect to the upper Riemann-Stiele sum. So now we have to prove U of PF alpha is greater than or equal to U of P star F alpha. So almost the procedure is same. So now what we will do? So hypothesis once again same. P star is a refinement of P, right? So P star is a refinement of P and P is taken as x naught, x1, so on, xn minus 1, xn. And the P star contains only one extra point more than that of P. So P union X star is nothing but P star. So all these hypotheses are same. And suppose X star is in between XJ minus 1, XJ. So this is common for both the parts, lower Riemann-Stiele sum and upper Riemann-Stiele sum. Now, So with respect to lower Riemann Stieler sum, we have to calculate the infimum. With respect to the upper Riemann Stieler sum, we have to calculate the supremum. So define mi to be supremum of f of x as x varies over any ith interval. So p is this. So once again, the same. So partition p consider. So x naught, x1, x2, so on, xn minus 1, xn. So this is the partition P. So with respect to each closed interval, we calculate the supremum and we will name it as mi. We'll name it as mi. Then what will be the upper Riemann Stieler sum? It will be simply summation mi delta alpha I running from 1 to n. Okay. Now, in addition to these points, so if I add x star, then it will give you the partition P star. So suppose it lies in between xj minus 1 and xj. So then it is inside the jth interval. So as we argued in the previous part, the same thing here also. Suppose P star contains one point more than that of P, which is x star, and which lies in between xj minus 1 and xj. Right? So now, as it is in the jth interval, just we shall highlight the jth term of this summation. So I running from 1 to j minus 1, mi delta alpha I, put I is equal to j, so mj delta alpha j, then remaining summation, I running from j plus 1 to n. So up to j minus 1, jth term after j plus 1 term. So like this. So this will be UPF alpha, that is Riemann, the lower Riemann Stieler sum with respect to the partition P. So now what if I want to write the Riemann Stieler sum, that is upper Riemann Stieler sum with respect to P star. So now if I observe the partition P star, so up to the J minus 1th interval, so all the intervals are same, right? X0 to X1, X0 to X2, X2 to X3. So all the intervals are same as that of P. So P is this. So A is equal to X0, X1, X2, so on, Xj minus 1, Xj, so on, Xn minus 1, Xn. So this is the jth interval of the partition P. So in place of that jth interval, we have two intervals. So in case of P star, so this is the only difference once again. So in case of UPF alpha, that is upper Riemann Stieler sum, so this is the jth term as there is only one interval. So in place of that, there are two intervals in case of P star. So, but rest all the same, rest all the same. So before the jth interval and after the jth interval, so the terms or the sub intervals are one and the same between P and P star. So if I want to write upper Riemann Stieler sum U P star F alpha up to J minus 1th interval, the same terms mi delta alpha I running from J minus 1, but the jth term. So I have defined W1 as the supremum of f of x as x varies over the interval xj minus 1 to x star. W2 as supremum of all f of x as x varies from, sorry, I have written in reverse. So here, so this interval has to be from x star to xj, x star to xj. So the jth interval xj minus 1 xj is now divided into 2. So w1 is the supremum with respect to the points of this interval, and w2 is the supremum of the function values with respect to the points of this interval. So w1 into alpha of upper limit, that is x star minus alpha of lower limit, plus w2 into alpha of upper limit minus alpha of lower limit, plus after the jth interval, the rest of the terms are same. Now once again, take the difference of 1 and 2. So consider UP F alpha minus U of P star F alpha. So accept the jth term, rest all terms are same in case of both. So they get cancelled when you take the difference. So remaining is, this is the jth term of UP F alpha and this is the jth term of u p star f alpha. So once again do the same thing. So what is delta alpha j? It is alpha of xj minus alpha of xj minus 1. So add and subtract alpha of x star, then take the common. So finally you will obtain mj minus w1 minus into alpha of x star minus alpha of xj minus 1, mj minus w2 into alpha of xj minus alpha of x star. So now we have to find the relation between w1 and mj, w2 and mj. So what is mj? It is supremum of all f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 to xj. So whereas w1 is supremum of all f of x as x varies from xj minus 1 to x star, and w2 is supremum of all f of x as x varies from x star to xj. So this is how we have. So this is the interval xj minus 1 to xj. So for mj is what? Mj is the supremum of all function values as x varies over the whole interval. So mj is the least upper bound for the function values as x varies from xj minus 1 to xj. But in between there is x star, and with respect to this we have divided this interval into two. Now for all the function values, for all the function values for the points from xj minus 1 to x star, we have taken w1 as the supremum, and for all function values with respect to the points from x star to xj, we have taken w2 to be the supremum. So w1 is the least upper bound for function values with respect to these points, w2 is the least upper bound for all function values with respect to these points. But mj is upper bound for all these points. Mj is a supremum for all f of x values for points from this. So it is an upper bound, and in particular w1 is least upper bound for function values with respect to these points. So mj in particular, it is upper bound for in this range, it is least upper bound, right? So mj becomes upper bound in this range, and w1 is least upper bound. Mj becomes upper bound in this range, w2 is least upper bound in this case. So mj is an upper bound, w1 is least upper bound. Mj is an upper bound, w2 is a least upper bound. So w1 will be less than or equal to mj, w2 will be less than or equal to mj. So w1 minus mj will be less than or equal to 0, or mj minus w1 is non-negative, mj minus w2 is non-negative. So this is non-negative, this is non-negative, and by the increasing property of alpha, this is also non-negative, this is also non-negative. So entirely the right hand side term is non-negative, hence the left hand side which is equal to it will be non-negative. So what we get finally, up f alpha is greater than or equal to up star f alpha. So we proved this for any refinement P star of P when it contains one point more than that of P. If at all P star contains K points more than P, so what you argued for a single point, repeat the same for all rest of the points. So finally you will obtain the same result, which is U P F alpha greater than or equal to U P star F alpha. And this completes the proof. So the result which we have proved is with respect to refinement of a partition. So for any partition P and for any refinement P star of P, LP F alpha is less than or equal to L P star F alpha, and UP F alpha is greater than or equal to UP star F alpha. So remember this result. So we will be using this many times in future.